Speaking of summer, I'm telling you, madness is on us now. The mad season is happening. Things are just getting out of hand. Terrible. Getting out of hand. I mean, the way Archie Bunker says that, things are getting out of hand. I mean, if you think it's only America... See, I think there's something going on in the animal world. I really do. Have you noticed the animals are getting awful pushy? I mean, let's face it, we're living in a time when a rat can become a major movie star. Ben, he's a big-time star now. In fact, he's working more than Warren Beatty is these days. I'll tell you this, he's getting a hell of a lot better reviews, too. You know, the one thing about a rat, I've never seen a rat get a bad review. No, I've never seen an animal get a bad review in a movie. Ever. They're really making it, gee. And, there's no question about it that the cockroach population is on the increase. And they are getting everywhere. But I tell you, turtles are overrunning. Did you know that Florida right now is having a massive invasion of giant snails? Did you hear about that? These snails are they're the size of grapefruits. Big babies. I mean, they are. And they climb up and down the trees. Tremendous. What about the walking catfish? You know about them, right? Well, let me tell you, some night when you go out to your lawn, friend, and you find a 4-foot walking catfish out there fighting you for who's going to control a sprinkler, you are going to think different about the animal world, I'll tell you this. And it's happening, it's not only here, it's happening all over the world. Listen to this one. Cardiff, Wales. A little note came in on the United Press. Cardiff, Wales. Now, what does Cardiff mean to you? Now, why is it that my mind attracts crummy little pieces of information like magnetic static attraction? You know, when you take a comb and you ever do that? You take a comb and you rub it on your pants or something real strong, like on a piece of cloth, and the comb will pick up all, you know, little pieces of junk and lint and paper and all that stuff. That's static. Electricity does that. Well, I think some minds are affected with mental static electricity. And they pick up lint. They pick up the lint of human knowledge. Now, a comb will not pick up real stuff like pins, you know, metal. It picks up what? Lint. Junk. That's what static electricity does. I think my mind is picking up this lint. Why is it that I, reading Cardiff, Wales, I immediately think of something Cardiff. Now, you all have you all are subjected to the same American myth and life, and you're part of the same background, right? We're all Americans here in this crowd, okay. Well, then why in the world don't you relate to Cardiff? Well, have any of you ever heard the expression, the Cardiff giant? Okay. Well, then why is it that my mind made the connection immediately, Jerry, and yours didn't? In spite of the fact that that Cardiff was mentioned. Well, if you don't know what the Cardiff giant is, the back of my hand to you, and I won't even discuss it with you. You'll have to find it out for yourself. That'll be supplementary reading. Go ahead and find out. But anyway, Cardiff, Wales. Patients at the Lansdowne Hospital in Cardiff can be forgiven for thinking they are delirious when they see horses galloping up and down a hospital corridor. Think of the picture. Horses galloping up and down the hospital corridor. I want you to imagine this. But the horses are real. These are real horses. And, quote, I'm quoting the UPI piece, frequently invade the hospital grounds. No one, in one case, five amorous stallions. Do you know what an amorous stallion is like? In one case, five amorous stallions chased a large group of mares through the hospital building, through the wards, and out into the night. What a hell of a racket. And we are quoting a spokesman.
You have no idea where they come from, but they get in from time to time.
We have no idea where they come from. Wait a minute. A flock of amorous stallions chasing a group of mares. We have no idea where they come from, quote, but they get in from time to time. What a Marcus Welby sequence that would make. Can't you see old Marcus sitting there, you know, investigating his patient, and all of a sudden... Four Arabs, three Appaloosas, a quarter horse, and one mare of unknown parentage have just roared through the reception room, trailing smoke. You like that sequence? That was not bad, was it? I don't know where it comes from, I tell you. You got that commercial in there. There's nothing to cool off a fevered brow than a... I almost said something. Nothing to cool off a fevered brow than a commercial. I suspect that one of the reasons my mind does these bad things, you know, like imagines these horses galloping through Marcus Welby's place. I concede that James Reston wouldn't have a thought like that. And I'm convinced that Eric Sephiroth wouldn't think of that thing. Well, I'll tell you one of the reasons. It's because of some early traumatic experiences that I had. And I'll tell you one of them. One night. I've had some traumatic experiences with animals. Really traumatic. For example, one night... Now, this is going to sound like fiction, but I'm just going to lay it out just the way it is. One of the very first automobiles that I had, which I loved dearly, except the fact that it burned 7 gallons of oil per mile, which was all right since I used oil in it anyway that I got at the Shell station. But nevertheless, this car was a convertible Ford, which I had spent a lot of work and time doing, you know, everything conceivable that I could do to it. I put in new floor mats, beautiful, you know, and I cut them myself, see, and I fixed the upholstery. I had this Naugahyde upholstering, you know, and I fixed the upholstering in it. And me and my brother and Schwartz one time patched the top. That's not easy. I know that you've ever patched the top of a convertible. It's not easy, see. In fact, I even put a new plastic window in the back of the top. You know, that's really rough, man. And I ground the valves, and I dropped it and hacked it and leaded it. And, oh, it was just beautiful. Well, one night... Nice, soft summer night just like this. I had the top down. And I drove out to the beach. And I was with this guy, a couple of friends of mine. There was Schwartz and Flick, and I think Lawrence Stryker was with. In fact, Lawrence Stryker was with. Subsequent investigation proved that he was the primary victim of what happened. But I parked the car in this parking lot at the beach. And we went down, and you know, we did all the stuff you do at the beach, walked around and scratched and look at the chicks and, you know, do the whole scene, ate hot dogs and drank root beer and came back and walked around and looked at the chicks and drank hot dog, you know, the whole bit, see. And now it's about 11 o'clock. The beach closed at midnight. So we figured what we're going to do is leave about maybe an hour early, see. That way we could stop by the Red Rooster lay in some pizza or something on the way back, you know. So we had enough anyway. So we go out to the parking lot. Now, the parking lot, you know how beaches are. Beaches tend to be not in the middle of town, right? You agree with that? Well, we were in the dunes, which is part of, you probably heard of the Indiana Dunes, right? Well, this was you haven't? Well, in which case, we have no communication whatsoever. You have heard of Italy, haven't you? You did? You heard of Italy? You heard of Paris? Well, oh, God. Now, this is WOR New York, but nevertheless, this was the Indiana Dunes, and so I came walking out. I got the keys out, and I've always had a deadly fear of losing the keys to the car at the beach. A deadly fear. Now, it's never happened to me yet, and maybe I shouldn't mention it, because once you mention something like that, it's going to happen. I mean, it's going to happen. Well, I always had this deadly fear of losing the keys. And I always had this great feeling of relief when when I've left the beach and I'm on my way to the parking lot and I got the keys right in my hand. Well, I had the keys, see. And I'm still wearing my bathing suit, which was lucky under the circumstances. Still got my bathing suit on, but I am wearing some sandals. Got these sandals. And I'm flopping. You know the kind of sandals you get with the rubber tire soles on them? Okay. So I'm flopping along in the sandals, and I got my T-shirt on that says White Sox or something. And it's kind of nice and warm out. Well, I go around the side of the car. Now, the top was down, remember. I go around the side of the car, so it's, you know, there's no point in locking the door of a car that the top is down. So I walk around the side, and I swing the door open, and I slide in. This is, you know, Naugahyde upholstery, the whole bit, see, and I slide in. My bathing suit's still a little bit wet. And the back seat of the car, see, it's a convertible. It's a back seat, see. So Schwartz climbs right over the back of the car and slides into the back seat. And also, so does Flick. He goes right over. Now they're in the back, these two. Well, Lawrence Stryker comes around the other side of the car, and it's still dark, see? And I'm starting the car. I put the keys in the lock, you know, and this was a Ford. It had one of these steering wheel locks on it. You know, you put the key in the lock, and I flip the switch. Oh, it sounded so great, you know. I love this. You know, so... Oh, I had Hollywood pipes and the whole thing on it. And so they're great, you know. So listen to that power, man. And I'm just, you know, just revving it up. And Stryker swings the door open. Well, as he did it, I was aware of something. Now, nothing had happened at this point. I was aware of something just at the instant Stryker pulled the door open. He was on the other side, see, from me. And he slid in, and it was fantastic. He slid in, pulled his feet in, pulled the door, and he had the door almost closed. I've rarely seen a person do what he did. You know, I think people and animals, anything else, are capable of unbelievable physical feats under the proper motivation. Well, Stryker went absolutely in a vertical trajectory. He literally flew straight up in the air. He let out a sort of a bleat. Some kind of a crazy bleat. And he flew straight up in the air, and he just sort of fell half out over the door and out into the parking lot. He took off like a rocket. And I said, "What's the matter?" He said, "Look." Well, it was just too late. Just as I looked, it happened. In the front seat with us was a big, and I mean an adult, a big operating skunk. Well, you wonder what skunks do when they're operating? Well, I don't have to tell you. It's true. He really let go. Well, he not only let go, but the skunks are very agile. I never really had much relationship with skunks outside of, you know, there was a guy named Mr. Wilson once, and in my freshman year, he was a terrible skunk, and there were a few other, you know, skunks. There was Farkas, there was Grover Dill, but I mean real skunks. Well, now, the first thing you find out about a skunk, once you ever have any real contact with a skunk, is that they are fantastically agile. They move in a strange way. Have you ever seen them go? They go like waves. They billow out. It's funny. Well, a skunk, he let go. Whoosh, doop, boop. Just like that, Flick is hiding under the back seat. Schwartz is trying to burrow his way through the floorboards. And Stryker is laying outside on the concrete, trying to get under the car and yelling and hollering. Well, this baby, this skunk, just as cool as you want to, you know, he was an old hand at this kind of thing. He just oozed over the right up over the dashboard of the car. I don't know how he did. He just oozed up, just right over the side of the door, over the hood, and gone. He just whoop, gone. Well, at least. Now, let's put it this way. He was gone, but I'll tell you, he left his impression on us. He left... Oh, boy. Well, you know, we... Of course, Stryker got back in a car, and he'd been on the floor, this skunk. He'd just been on the floor. Now, what he was doing on the floor of the car, out in the parking lot, I have no idea, but there he was. Well, that night, we were kind of stunned. We drove over to Red Rooster. They wouldn't let us in. Why was it ever gamey? We drove home. You know, the worst part of living with the smell of skunk is you get used to it. And about an hour of driving around, all four of us were used to smelling like skunks. We just, you get used to it, but nobody else was used to it. Every place we'd go, I'd say, what's that smell? Well, I must have worked on that car. The one thing that you'll find out, and you find out doggone quick, if a skunk ever lets go inside of your car, is that there's no way to get rid of it ever. That car, to the day I got rid of it, smelled like skunk. No matter what I did, I used Lysol, the whole bit. You know, just smelled like skunk. No way to get out of it. And the only time it really, of course, with the top down, it was kind of okay. But let me tell you this, you put the top up on a convertible on a rainy day with the windows up, and it starts steaming up inside. Oh, I'm telling you, it made my face green just smelling it, saying nothing I could do. Well, all right, now, once you've had a traumatic experience with an animal like that, you don't look at animals the way other people look at. You know, like Marlon Perkins, he kind of looks at him with that kindly, jovial eye. Well, there were other experiences, like one time in the Army. You want to hear about another experience of an animal nature in the Army? All right. I'll tell you. We were out, this is another moment of truth. We were out, I'm in this radar company, and we're out in the boondocks, and in the sand, and the palmettos, and in the heat. And we'd been working for about 3 days trying to put up an antenna. Well, now, when you put up this antenna, you dig these holes in the ground, right? And you put poles in the ground, metal things, and the places where you attach the guy wires. Now, there's a lot of jazz like that. So I don't want to burden you with technical problems here, but putting up an antenna demands digging holes in the ground. It demands cutting down the weeds, too, in certain places. So old Company K is out there cutting away and chopping and hacking. And we're digging out the palmettos and cutting the holes in the ground. And I'm sitting casually with Goldberg. Now, me and Goldberg had been in Company K together for as long as Company K was in existence. Went back to the early Boer War. And that we had seen it all. I'll tell you, we'd been through everything. Yeah, we'd had four first sergeants, each one worse than the one before them. We'd had five company commanders, worn them all out. And that Company K, like the sands of the Sahara, went on. Officers rose and fell. First sergeants disappeared and crumbled, but Company K went on. So me and Goldberg are sitting there quietly. We're sitting next to the wheel of what is called in the Army a prime mover. Now, that's a great name, by the way, prime mover. In fact, I always thought that would be a great name for a rock group. You know, Deuce and a Half and the Prime Movers. What a great name, you know, prime mover. But the prime mover is a real, it's exactly what it is. You know what the name implies. The word prime mover means this is a prime mover. And it's a big truck, you have big fat tires and big wide brake drums. And you can see that brake shaft, you know, the drive shaft running through it. It weighs about 40 tons. And me and Goldberg are squatting down next to the wheel, the back wheel, of the prime mover. And it's hot. We've been digging in the sand, and we've been chopping away at palmettos. And when you work at that kind of stuff, you get little cuts all over your hand. This is one thing you find in working in the boondocks. You constantly got cuts and torn fingernails. So we're sitting back there, scrunching down on our haunches. Both of us, incidentally, wearing nothing but GI shorts. Because it's very hot. It's 110 degrees in this place. We're wearing GI shorts. We got GI shoes. And that's it. Dog tags hanging, sweating away. Well, now, we had just taken a break to eat. Now, we were way out in the field. We were like 1,700 miles away from anything. And so we were eating K rations. Now, a K ration, if you don't know what a K ration, this is dry rations. We'd opened up the K boxes, and we're chomping away. And I had gotten one with the cheese. See, K rations was like playing Russian roulette. You never knew what you'd get in them. Now, there was one, yeah, that's right. You may open a box that says breakfast on the side of it. They had breakfast ones, they had lunch types, and dinner types. But a lot of times, we would just get a whole bunch of brown boxes that didn't say anything on them. So you open it up, and there's a little can. You open up the can, and what do you got? You got petrified scrambled eggs. Which, yeah, that's right. Have you ever had canned eggs? Well, that's a very interesting experience. You get canned eggs with little ground-up bits of what appeared to be ersatz fried bacon mixed up with the petrified eggs. So I'm spooning away at the eggs. and Goldberg is next to me chewing on the chocolate bar. There was a special type of chocolate bar that came with the K-rations that had a very strange taste. But anyway, it was sweet. So he's sitting down there. He's chewing away on his candy bar. When it happened, the second major trauma that I had ever experienced in the animal world. I mean, the skunk was all right. And there was no harm in the skunk. After all, he just sprayed us with his stuff and left. Well, I'm squatting down there by the wheel. I turned to Goldberg. It was a funny thing. It was like it was in the air. I said to Goldberg, "Hey, Goldberg, do you hear anything?" Goldberg was chewing away on this chocolate bar. When you chewed K-ration chocolate bar, you couldn't hear much because it crunched. You know, in your teeth, he's chomping away. I said, "Stop chewing for a minute, Goldberg, and listen. Do you hear something?" He said, "Yeah." I said, "Goldberg, is this prime mover got a flat? Is this damn tire got a leak in it?" Here we are, we're sitting right next to the tire, see? Trying to get some shade. That's why we were sitting next to the tire. I said, "Does that tire have a leak in it?" And it was a faint sound. It was going. Goldberg says, "Yeah, I think it has. This thing's leaking. Just steady." It goes. Well, now there's something about a tire that leaks. If you're automobile oriented, if you're an automobile cuckoo, and both Goldberg and I were automobile cuckoos, that makes you want to do something about it. Well, what do you do? How do you detect a leak on a tire? Do any of you know? Well, first of all, you put your head down and you listen. You move your ear around to find out where, roughly, the sound is coming from. And now, one of the great ways of finding a leak is to spit on your hand. Just spit on your hand and smear saliva over the spot you think is leaking, and bubbles will come out. You can see the bubbles, see? So Goldberg says, "Hey," he says, "you know, I think this thing is leaking." I says, "Yeah, I think it is." And it's good. You go, "Shh." Well, now, in the Army, especially in Company K, you had to look awful hard to find something that would break the boredom. I mean, we worked in boredom. I mean, I'm telling you, as a matter of fact, boredom became a physical object in Company K. It was not a state of mind any longer. You could actually taste it. For those of you who don't know what boredom tastes like, I'll tell you, it has a tinny taste. It tastes a little bit like old metal spoons. You know that funny? That's the way boredom tastes. And it has a feel. You can feel it brushing your face once in a while when you walk. When you're on your way down to the latrine or something, you can feel it. You can feel it brush your face. It feels like very, very soft, like cobwebs. And it kind of itches a little bit when it touches you. And so anything that would break the boredom of digging holes in the sand, of standing around endlessly while they kept pulling the guy wires tight, anything, we would grasp like a dog grabbing a hold of a 2-pound sirloin steak. Well, the fact that this tire was leaking was great. You know, give us something to do. See, and it's going. So Goldberg says, "You work on that side." He says, "It's leaking." So we both start with our ears up against the tire. These were huge tires. Remember, this is a prime mover. They have tires about half the size of the Time Life building. So he said, "I'm going around." I said, "Goldberg, it sounds like it's back in the back there, near the differential where you are, see?" He said, "Yeah, I think it is." And he's in the back, I'm in the front, see? And Goldberg says, "No, wait a minute." He spits in his hand. He said, "I'm going to try it." So he goes like that, and he reaches on the side of the tire, and just like that, just at that instant, it goes whap. It moved like a shadow. It's fantastic. Just out of the darkness, next to that brake drum, it came. A shadow moved. Whap. Like that. And it went back. My God. It was a diamondback rattlesnake. Well, now, I don't know whether you've ever seen a working diamondback. It's not quite the same as watching it on Zoo Parade. Or the Walt Disney Hour on Sunday nights. It's a very different feeling. A very different feeling. Well, he just went back into the darkness. And Goldberg, he missed Goldberg. That was the one thing we had. He missed him. You know, and Goldberg had just reached in there, and apparently this baby just made one big, you know, he struck, but he missed. And they do, you know. This baby missed, and he had pulled back, and he was waiting again. Well, I want to tell you, Goldberg didn't reach in there again. I can assure you of that. Well, I saw Goldberg roll over backwards. Well, Goldberg weighed about 400 pounds. You think of the damnedest things when you're in the middle of a stress situation. Goldberg rolled over backward. Now, he weighed about 400 pounds. He wore his GI shorts, his dog tags, sweat, the whole bit, you know. He just, and he rolled over backward. And it was like a dying whale. It just hit me. Goldberg looks like a dying whale. Well, now, I'd never seen a dying whale, but Goldberg rolled over backwards. He gave a yell. And of course, I'm not about to reach behind that brake casing there to see whether or not that snake, you know, can do better on the next try. So I hollered. I said, "Snake! Snake!" Well, of course, Company K, being rife with boredom on all sides, instantly sprang into action by running. They ran. You never saw more guys diving into weeds because of what the snake was. Well, after about 5 minutes of milling around, everybody starts creeping up on that prime mover, and boy, I'll tell you, it was a talk about tension. Well, that snake had come out halfway into the sun, and he was moving very slowly. You ever seen a rattlesnake do that? He was just moving very slowly, just moving out. Because apparently the sun either blinded him or something. He couldn't see us, but he just kept moving out. And it was then that I realized how big that guy was. He must have been, I would say, close to 6 feet long. And at the biggest point of his body, I would say his body was about, 3 inches in diameter. Thick, heavy snake there. And that diamond, the diamond is so clear. You really see the diamond formation on the back of a diamondback rattlesnake. The sun, with the way it was hitting him, because snakes don't move much in the sun, especially a snake like that. And he was trying to get out of there, I guess. He didn't like it around there any more than we did, see? And he was moving real slow. And we all just stood around and watched him. But you know, the funny thing about it, we let him go. He just moved into the palmettos slowly and eased down a little bank and off into the woods. He must have been moving about 3 miles an hour, just moving. You could see those rattles on the back. Nobody touched him. Well, I think it was a combination of being afraid and surprise. I think the whole thing was a curious moment. But there is a traumatic moment with animals. Now, okay, once you have had a snake make a pass at you like that in the darkness, you change your view of snakes. Now, I'll tell you another one. You want to hear another traumatic moment? You know, if you live a certain kind of life, you run into these things. You know, you just can't help it. Animals, and it's not that I'm anti-animal. I'm just saying that once you have a traumatic moment with animals, you don't look at them the way you did before. Now, the next traumatic experience I'm going to have is a little more exotic. Curiously exotic. It happened in South Africa. In fact, in this particular instance, it was in the Kruger, this tremendous game preserve they've got. Now, this is not like a forest preserve. Don't get that in your head. This is a place where animals living, and they're there, see. And all they've done is set out a great big area where they say nobody can hunt them, and that's it, and they're there. And they're doing what they do. That's it. Well, I'm sitting in a Jeep, and we're driving along through the bush. Now, the bush looks like a lot of small bushes. The bush, most people tend to think of jungle, you know, tremendous jungles and all. But these were small scrub bushes and stuff. And kind of flat ground. Off in the distance, you see a low mountain. And it was hot, humid. Not excessively so, though. I'd say it was about 90 degrees. And it was pretty warm, but not really too bad. It's like a good hot summer day in New York, roughly. And it's Africa, see. And I'm riding along in a Jeep with a guy. And we just one lane. This is one little gravel road, see, that wound through this part of the brush. It was not even a gravel road, really. It was mostly just a few tracks, like. And we're rolling along. And we go around a clump of these small green trees, almost impenetrable. You couldn't see through them, see? And that's what made it so dramatic. We came around this clump, made a hairpin turn, just came around it. Oh, my God. He stopped. He just slammed on the brakes and stopped. Well, now, it is not easy to say that this was an animal experience. It was an animal experience, but it was not directly related to the animal itself. There, laying across the road, right in front of the bumper of the Jeep, we almost ran over it. He slammed on the brakes and stopped. Stretched right across the road was a disemboweled, full-grown adult male giraffe. What a sight. I mean, it was a fantastic sight. Here was this dead giraffe lying across the road. Now, a giraffe, an African giraffe, full grown, in the bush, will attain a height of around 20 to 22 feet. That's a fantastic animal. A giraffe is huge, unbelievably huge, much bigger than the ones you see in zoos. And he's lying just full length, right directly across the road. Well, it caught me by surprise. I said, what the hell? What? He backs up. He says, he's got to be around here somewhere. I said, what? He's been hit by a lion. And some lion had been dragging this giraffe, a dead giraffe, which was freshly killed, incidentally, and the entire road was drenched with blood and a lot of other stuff. Boy, it was an unbelievable sight. And the neck of the giraffe had been broken, and you could see these great, on the sides. See, a giraffe, you can imagine a giraffe in your mind, they have these big bulging sides, a beautiful animal, with this beautiful, soft, tawny coat, and you could see where these great claws had just ripped them. And somewhere around us was the boy that did it. probably a female, incidentally, because most of the hunting in lions is done by the females. And he says, do you want to take a picture? I said, no. I should have, actually, but I didn't. I says, no. And he says, well, we better get out. He says, because it can be problems. And so he just put the Jeep in reverse, and he backed up into the gravel. And we made a big, wide berth through the undergrowth, and we went on down the road. What a scene. Well, now, you never see anything like that in Born Free. You just don't see that kind. Elsa doesn't do that kind of stuff. Not that spectacularly, see. Well, just the sight of that fantastic animal lion, and it was ripped open. Just you have no idea what it looked like. And there must have been 40 gallons of blood. And the one final curious, scary touch was his eyes were open. Now, have you ever looked at a giraffe and looked at his eyes? They have gigantic, beautiful, dark brown eyes that are so brown and liquid and soft, they look almost like, well, they're Bambi eyes multiplied by 1,000. And these great, beautiful brown eyes were staring at the African sun. And a few flies had already started to drift down. You could hear them, because it was very silent around. And you hear, bzzz, you hear these buzzing, bzzz, these strange African insects. We drove on down through that gravel road. What a sight. Ever since that time, whenever I, like late at night, when I've got the TV set on. See, I'll turn on the TV set when I'm writing or doing something. The late, late movie comes on. And that MGM's insignia shows up. And that big old boy looks out of that MGM insignia and he goes, "Bleah! Bleah!" You know, the MGM lion? I sort of scrunch back. Take another sip of my bourbon. Because I can see in my mind, I see that beautiful, magnificent giraffe stretched across the road. Skunks. Giraffes. Diamondback rattlesnakes. Not to mention the fact that it still would make a great Marcus Welby episode. Can't you just see Marcus Welby talking to Richard Chamberlain, see? Suzanne Plachette has come in with a rare skin disease. And the Marcus Welby is looking very kindly at it. He's got that little, you know, that little round thing they wear on the top of their head, that little searchlight scene. He says, "Say ah, please." When suddenly, outside here, and then the titles come on. The Case of the Rampant Stallion. Marcus Welby, the galloping horses, through the reception room, kicking the old National Geographic's helter-skelter, knocking over the ashtrays. Yes, there's something going on in the animal world. Ben has become a movie star. What next? Where is it going to turn? By the way, wouldn't that be a fantastic... Marlon Brando Zoo Parade? What does he call that show? The one that Marlon the Perkins is on. Yeah, Wild Kingdom. You imagine Marlon Perkins starting out the beginning of the show. He says, "Now tonight we're going to go in and catch this big anaconda, and we're going to take him to a safe place where he can be a better anaconda." You know, they're always doing that kind of stuff, and he leaps in. And then the announcer comes in and says, "Ladies and gentlemen, due to an unfortunate occurrence, the rest of the program will be taken over by Mr. Perkins' assistant, who will describe the safekeeping of the anacondas." But I could tell you another story, but I don't want to tell you this story. Because, you know, the things that you have heard about piranhas, you've heard those things about piranhas. Well... I don't want to burden you with that one. Yes, right now. I want you to give me your undivided attention. Right now, something could be crawling under the rose trellis. Outside and back next to the garage. As I say, it's definite that there's a movement afoot. I don't know quite what it is. I don't know whether even McGovern can do anything about it. I mean, this is a pretty big movement. I mean, what with those walking catfish, those snails climbing up the side of trees. I'm telling you, it's on its way. Did you know that they recently found a wild armadillo in southern New York? That's right, you didn't know that, did you? The armadillo is a creature usually related to the tropics. They're moving north. They are finding armadillos in places as widely dispersed as Indiana, Arkansas, places like Minnesota. It's happening everywhere. The sound of creeping, crawling things. And the sound of claws scrunching on concrete. The sight of a yellow eye in the darkness as your headlight moves through the trees. Yes, it's happening, friends. This is WOR New York. You stay tuned for Lester Smith and the news.